In this lecture, I am going to give an answer to the question, the second question that was asked at the end of the previous lecture, whether how these ideas go into higher dimensions. That is roughly the question. We explore it in R3 and maybe make some statements about Rn, but before we really say what Rn is, there is no point in doing that, but we will do it in more general scenario later after introducing the linear spaces. So, we work with R3. R3 is very fascinating, in fact. In fact, we live in a three-dimensional world as far as physicists are concerned. Our space concept is three-dimensional and we are three-dimensional objects, and these terminology is so frequently used that you have some kind of intuitive feeling of what it is. But we will see what happens. We start from the intuitive notion and then slowly probably explore this and make them mathematically precise. So, let me draw a coordinate system that is suited for R3. So, you have got the usual conventional x axis, y axis and z axis. Now, this is the, although we are drawing it in a plane, trying to give a three-dimensional view of it, and you will have to do a little bit of imagination. But certainly a model of that is, if you look at the corner of the room, so you have one of them is x axis, the other one is y axis, and the vertical one is z axis. And with reference to these, one can give coordinates to each point. How does it come? So, you have a unit length measured along each of these axes. Now, you take an arbitrary point in space, draw a line perpendicular to the plane containing the x and y axis, or you say 1, 2 axis or 1, 2, 3. I think it is better to use 1, 2, 3 because that goes directly for generalization. So, draw a line perpendicular to it from P and let it meet the plane, you know, created by the two axes, one axis and two axis. That is the 1-2 plane, let me call it 1-2 plane at the point M. Now, what one does it? See, 1-2 plane is again our old two-dimensional R2. So, we do the same thing there. So, this point has representations. What one does is, you draw a line perpendicular to the one axis and another line perpendicular to the two axis. Now, this point is so R. So, find out, so the point N lies on the line, on the one line or one axis. Find out what is its designating number. Similarly, for R. And now, what one does is, you draw a perpendicular line to the axis 3 also, denoted by S. So, find out the coordinate of S and you write it as x1, x2, x3, where x1 equal to On, x2 equal to O R, x3 equal to S. Now, this could be positive or negative depending on where these numbers, I mean where these points lie on these lines. If it is on the negative part of it, then you get a negative number representing it. So this x1, x2, x3 can be positive or negative or even 0. Okay? So that is possible. So this is how it the three dimensional representation of a point comes out to be. That is the Cartesian coordinate to represent a point in space. Now, as before, every vector can be identified with a point in space. Now, we are talking about vectors in space, because you have a direction like this, a direction like this, a third direction like this, the three need not be in the same plane. So, these are all possible, whereas we examined only the case confining ourselves to planar vectors and just made a remark about the possibility of the higher dimensional spaces. So, let P be identified with the vector OP. So, that x1, x2, x3, so let me denote this by x. So, x is denoted by so, all vectors in R3 can be represented by points in R3 and they can be given represented by the coordinates with reference to a reference system that you have. Therefore, now we can talk about addition. So, if x, y is defined by y1, y2, y3, then x plus y is defined as x1 plus y1 y3. Similarly, you can scalar multiply it and you have k times x corresponds to and that also gives a vector in space. Okay? Now, we again go for the representation of a line. So, we start with a vector v belonging to R3. V has v3. We assume v is not equal to 0, which means v1 square plus v2 square plus v3 square is not equal to 0, means at least one of the component is different from 0, so that this is a non-zero vector. This is not a zero vector. Then look at this one. For t belonging to, this is the equation of a line. You take a vector and then elongate it, contract it and reverse its direction, you get a line generated by this. When you run t over the entire R, this will run on the line along that generated by the vector v. Once again, the scalar form of it is x1 equal to t v1, x2 equal to t v2, x3 equal to t v3, and which we usually if you eliminate t between this, it will give you a statement of ratios, namely x1 by, we write it in this way, and this is each one is equal to t, that is the meaning of that. So, you give different values for t, it is the ratio remains the same. There is a caution that you have to exercise here. This is not actually division by v1, It only says that x1, x2, x3 is proportional to v1, v2, v3. It's a restatement of that, but usually the equation of the line is classically written in this form, which allows v1, v2, v3 or at most two of them to be equal to 0. So, it is not division by 0, because division by 0 does not make any sense. Okay? So, this is, even if you may write x1 by 0 equal to x2 by 0 equal to x3 by some number. Okay? It shows, it talks about the slope of the line, and such interpretations are there, what are called the direction cosines of the line and so on. So, this is the classical equation of the line. This also means, those who are familiar with analysis or with analytical geometry know that this contains two planes intersecting along a line. If you take these two together, then it is a statement that x1 v2 equal to x2 v1. And if you take these two, then it says x2 v2 equal to x3 v2. Okay? So, even in the scenario where two of them become 0, you get this pair as well as this pair. So, which means you are talking about something where only the x3 axis is there. Okay? It is the intersection of x1, x3, x2 plane with x3, x1 plane. So, it's all lines passing through the origin can be obtained in this particular form. This is a clean form. There are no confusions here at all. T is the parameter, this is the parametric representation of the line. Whereas this, of course, pairwise if you take, then you have two planes. And the intersection of two planes gives the line. Therefore, you are talking about the intersection of the two planes giving you a line. Now, what happens to the scenario corresponding to the one that we examined in the case of R2? So, let us take any particular line in R3. What is that you can do now? Do the same exercise. There exists a unique line parallel to the given line passing through the origin. Okay? This comes from the fact that given a line and a point not lying on that line, there exists a unique line parallel to it lying in the plane determined by the line and the given point. Okay? It's a classical geometric result. So, there is a unique line. So, what is the equation of this line? So, let us see what is the general equation of the line and what is the equation of the line that you have. The general equation of the line is usually given by x1 minus this is the equation of a line passing through the point A1, A2, A3 having direction ratios V1, V2, V3. What are the direction ratios? Direction ratios are, see when you have this line, see it makes angles with each of these axes. So, if you use this as alpha, this as beta and this is gamma. Okay? That is the angle between the given line and the one axis is alpha, two axis is beta, the three axis is gamma, and you take cos alpha, cos beta, cos gamma, then they are known as the direction cosines of the line. Okay? It fixes the direction. In fact, you get cos square alpha plus cos square beta plus cos square gamma equal to 1. That is the relation that you have. And any scalar multiple of cos alpha, cos beta, cos gamma is what you call direction ratios. Okay, that is k times cos alpha, k times cos beta, k times cos gamma is direction ratio. So, once this is given, see that V1, V2, V3 is given, you can consider it as the direction ratios of the line. Okay? And you see that V1 divided by square root of V1 square plus V2 square plus V3 square, comma V2 divided by root of V1 square plus V2 square plus V3 square, comma V3 divided by root of V1 square plus V2 square plus V3 square, they are respectively cos alpha, cos beta and cos gamma. That is the meaning. So, that you get the sum of the squares is equal to 1. So, when you take an arbitrary line in space, there is the unique line passing through the origin parallel to it. Both of them have the same direction ratios. Okay? Now, this is the, so this corresponds to what are called the direction ratios, and this is some particular point passing through that. Suppose this form of the equation is given, the line is given in this particular form, then what does it mean? It means x1 minus a1 equal to tv1. x2 minus a2 equal to tv2, x3 minus a3 equal to tv3. Or this I can write, so this is x1 this I can write in the vector form, x is equal to x plus a, or x equal to minus a. That is the equation of the general straight line given in the vector form. So, given the scalar form, you can immediately write in the vector form, reversing the steps you can write it in the scalar form. So, this is always possible. So, the first step is in whatever form this line is given, because sometimes this line would be given as the intersection of two planes. In that case, you will have to find out the equation of the line of intersection and put it in this particular form. Once you put it in this particular form, you can immediately write down the equation of the line in the vector form. So, going from the scalar form to the vector form and the vector form to the conventional scalar form is very simple, and it is more or less like what we did earlier. Okay? So, again if you examine what has happened here. So, see V is some vector along this direction. So, x is equal to tv will be this line. Okay? What you are doing is you are picking a point A on this and then just translating it parallelly. So, it is the same process that takes place in R3 also. So, this can be interpreted as a line passing through the origin is translated through, in the representation I have given, through minus A, such that the origin is moving, kept moving parallelly and keeping the line parallel to the point A. That is what it is. That is about the lines in R3. But in R3, you also have planes. This is something extra that comes that is not there in R2. In fact, what happens is you have also the analog of that is there, the line is the analog of the plane. Okay? So that is what you have. So what is the equation of a line in R3? You are familiar with this. It is A1 X1. When I write like this, the meaning is this. I am talking about a set such that this condition is satisfied. This set is what you call a plane. Okay? Now, how do you represent the plane in a vector form? Okay? This needs some little bit of extra work that we have to do. So, I will return to R2 and then come back to R3 again. Okay? So, let us see what is the scenario. The scenario is this. You have a plane passing through the origin, and you have also a parallel plane in space. Now, this is given by B. What is the equation of this plane? Plane passing through the origin. The plane passing through the origin, the equation is given by, you know that it is A1 X1 is the unique plane parallel to the given plane and passing through the origin. So, given an arbitrary plane, there exists a unique plane passing through the origin, and if the equation of the given plane is A1 x1 plus A2 x2 plus A3 x3 equal to B, then the equation of the plane parallel to it passing through the origin is A1 x1 plus A2 x2 plus A3 x3 equal to 0. Okay? Now, we want to express this in the form of in the vector form. How do we do this? Now, this before we do that, we return to the R2. So, let us go back to R2. In R2, suppose you choose a single non-zero vector. If you choose a single non-zero vector, then there is a line passing through the origin. Okay? So, with a single non-zero vector u, one can get all the points on the line x equal to tu. This is what we have seen. Okay? But that does not cover the whole space. Right? So, to cover other points also, what do you do? Along with this, you choose another vector. If I choose another vector v along the same line, what do I get? I once again reproduce this. Now, what are the tools I have? Given vectors, I can do two things on that. Namely, you can add them, you can scalar multiply them, you can scalar multiply both by different scalars and add. So, all these manipulations can be done. Okay? But if I choose a V which lies along the same line x equal to tu and do these manipulations, what I do is I keep on getting the same line. I don't get anything new, because you know that given two vectors, they add up using parallelogram law. So, if I take two vectors lying along this line and apply parallelogram law, I get another point on the same line and I don't get anything new. So, what I do? I take a vector, because I have plenty of vectors not covered by this. I can certainly find another vector v which is not lying on this line. Okay? So, choose a vector v not equal to by u. Now, the question is, with u and v together and with the mechanism that you have a machinery. The machinery can scalar multiply them, add them. This is something that it can do. So, is it possible for this to manufacture every vector in R3? This is the question that you ask. So, you have a vector v. This is your V, and then now you see this is x equal to SV, where S belongs to R, is another line. So, if you simply take them separately, you do not get other point. There are a lot of points not covered, but how to reach them? What you do is, suppose you have an arbitrary point here. Okay? It's a vector. Some vector w is given. Now, you draw a parallelogram with w as a diagonal and the sides as along the vector u and v. So, what you do? You complete the parallelogram. And obtain points P and Q on the line LU, and this is LV. Therefore, what about the coordinates of P? The coordinates of P is some scalar multiple of U. Okay? So, P is OP is equal to a vector which is of the form alpha u, and OQ is some beta v. So, there exists scalars alpha and beta such that OP equal to alpha u, OQ equal to beta v. Okay? What does it indicate? It indicates that any given vector w, then, and you also have OP plus OQ equal to OR, which is equal to say w, that is w. Therefore, w is equal to alpha u plus beta v. What you have shown is that there exist scalars alpha and beta uniquely determined such that w is equal to alpha u plus beta v. Okay? And w is arbitrarily chosen. Since w is arbitrarily chosen, it shows that any vector in R2 can be represented as a linear combination of u and v. Okay? Since alpha u plus beta v called a linear combination of so hereafter we will be using this term. Okay. So what do you mean by a linear combination is a expression like alpha u plus beta v. Okay. So it can be represented as a linear combination of u and v. Now this is fascinating. Okay. And by in the way in which we have chosen even u and v, we have only insisted on only one thing, namely u is not equal to 0, v is not equal to 0, they are not along the same lines. Okay. Then with that you can generate the entire R2 this. So these two vectors generate the entire R2. Keep this in mind, later this is what is going to come as the so called basis, okay, for linear spaces. Right? Just keep this in mind. Now I can go back to this problem. We left there with a plane. Okay? So what is the vector representation of a plane? This is the question that you have. Again, the strategy is like what we did with the line. What is that? Given a plane, you discover the plane that is parallel to it and passing through the origin. There you use this idea. What is this idea? You can choose two vectors in that plane to generate the whole plane. Okay? All that you need is to be sure of is that both these vectors are non-zero. Secondly, they lie in that particular plane and their one is not a scalar multiple of the other. These are the precautions that you have to take. Therefore, you can make a choice of u and v lying in that plane. U is not a scalar multiple of v and u is not equal to u and v are not 0. Then using that you can generate the whole plane. Therefore, what you do? So, we start with a with this plane. Now, we start with this. So, given one, back to R3, given equation one, what one does is choose two vectors plane 2. What is the meaning of that? This condition translates to that u1, u2, u3 and v1 is you have a1 equal to 0. Okay, that is a condition. Right? So, to choose two sets of points u1, u2, u3, both non-zero, such that a1 u1 plus a2 u2 plus a3 u3 equal to 0, a1 v1 plus a2 v2 plus a3 v3 equal to 0, u1 u2 u3 is not a scalar multiple of v1 v2 v3, that is all. Okay? And you are given originally that a1 square plus a2 square not equal to 0, so that not all these ai's are 0, in that case this statement is meaningless. So, you see that there exist such points. When you have a trivial plane, there exist such points v1, u1, u2, u3 and v1, v2, v3. Clear? Having got that, now what do you do? In that plane, you are going to represent every vector as a linear combination of this. Therefore, if x is any vector in that plane, so x, if then x equal to tu plus sv, where t and s are arbitrary constants. So, the entire plane is now generated by choosing different values of t and s. So, this is the vector representation of the plane passing through the origin. Now, one little exercise is that given x equal to tu plus sv, where t and s are arbitrary, show that it represents a plane of the type a1 x1 plus a2 x2 plus a3 x3 equal to 0. How do we do that? See, this corresponds to three sets of equations. What are the three sets of equations? The three sets of equations are x1 is equal to where t and s are parameters, so the problem now is you have three equations and two unknowns. What are the unknowns? T and s. Eliminate t and s, then you get the equation of the surface that is governed by these parametric equations. So, what is that? This will be, so eliminate these three equations. Now, we recall something from our matrix theory or linear equations. Now, you see that this demands that the coefficients of t and s and 1 becomes the determinant equal to 0. So, you have, or this leads to, that is the equation. Okay? Essentially, what you are doing is, you are taking any two of them solving for T and S and substituting in the third equation, okay, and show that this is exactly what happens. So, it is an exercise. What is the exercise? The exercise is that, so to eliminate T and S between these three equations, you get, if you eliminate this, then this is the equation that you get. This is the determinant of x 1, x 2, x 3, u 1, u 2, u 3, v 1, v 2, v 3 equal to 0. How you arrive at is this, take any two of these equations, solve for T and S, okay, that can be done. At least one pair will be there where it can be done, certainly, because you are taking u and v linearly, not along the same direction. Therefore, it can be done certainly for at least one pair of equations, which shows that you can solve them for T and S in terms of, suppose it is the second equation and the third equation, then you will be solving for T and S in terms of x 2, x 3, u 2, u 3, v 2, v 3. Okay? And then what you do? You get values for T and S, substitute in the first equation. Okay? Then you get a relation. That relation will be the eliminant of T and S from between these three equations. And that you can see is essentially taking a very nice form, which is the determinant of x 1, x 2, x 3, u 1, u 2, u 3, v 1, v 2, v 3. It is a good thing to verify this. Okay? So, I leave it as an exercise. Verify. And if you expand this, what will you get? You will get x 1 times this determinant minus x 2 times this determinant plus x 3 times another determinant. So, it is of the form a 1 x 1 plus a 2 x 2 plus a 3 x 3 equal to 0. Okay? So, that represents a line passing through the, a plane passing through the origin. Okay? Therefore, you can go from the scalar form to the vector form. How do you do that? You given the equation, you write the equation of the plane parallel to it and passing through the origin. Choose two vectors which are where one is not the scalar multiple of the other and both are not equal to 0. And then the next thing is that you take linear combinations of them, that will determine the whole plane. So, you can write the vector form. Okay? Given the vector form, you can immediately write down the scalar form. Okay? Then what you see is that, so having got this particular equation of this particular plane in the vector form, what one does is get the other plane. How to get the other plane now? Because you know that the two planes are parallel. So, what did you do in the case of R2? You parallelly moved the plane, the line to meet the other line. Here what you do is, you take this particular plane and then move it parallelly to meet the other plane. And this parallel transport of the plane will be represented by, so, what you do is, you choose a vector lying on this plane, say something like this, some a, okay, then translate the whole thing. So, the equation of the plane that is obtained by translation will be x is equal to T u plus S v plus a. Okay? This will be the equation of the original plane. where A belongs to, A is a vector lying on the given plane. A is a point, A is a vector in the given plane means, it does not mean that the whole vector lies in that plane. Only means the tip of that actually lies in that plane, or the point corresponding to A is a point lying in that plane. So, now you can take an exercise. Find the vector numbers. Next exercise, some exercises, get a feeling of this. Okay. What is the equation of this x1, x2 plane? It is x3 equal to 0. Similarly, the other one is x1, x3 is x2 equal to 0. So, that is of the form a1, x1 plus a2, x2 plus a3, x3 equal to 0. Okay. Now, you find the corresponding plane and get the vector form and then verify all. Now, here again you see that the choice of u and v is not unique. As it is clear, in that plane u and any u and v you could have chosen, where u is not equal to 0, v is not equal to 0, v is not a scalar multiple of u. That would have been possible. Okay? So, that is about this. See, we can give an analytic proof of this statement, because we relied completely on geometry to say that given u and given a plane, you can choose two vectors such that every vector in that plane can be written as a linear combination of those two vectors. Give an analytic proof of it. What is that you have to do? See, you take R2. In R2, you choose two vectors u such that then any vector x can be represented as a linear sum of that is their x is beta v. How do we prove this? I mean, without referring to that, Okay. So we take this. What does this mean? This means x1 equal to alpha u1 plus beta v1. X2 equal to alpha u2 plus beta v2. So this is the unknowns are here, alpha and beta. X1, x2 is given. So you choose x1, x2. Then alpha and beta are the unknowns. So what you want to show is that from these two equations you can determine alpha and beta. U1, u2 is given, v1, v2 is given, x1, x2 is given, then that uniquely determines alpha and beta. So these are simple linear equations, okay, linear inhomogeneous equations in two variables, okay. So we can actually, the unknowns are alpha and beta. Now you see that there exists if and only if determinant of not equal to 0. What does it mean? It means these two columns are, one column is not a scalar multiple of the other, and this is some of the things that you have to prove. In a 2 by 2 matrix, the determinant is 0 if and only if one column is a scalar multiple of the other, and this is an if and only if condition, okay. So what is, that is exactly what we have ruled out here. We have said that u and v are non-zero and u is not a scalar multiple of v, and therefore this determinant is not equal to 0, therefore there exists a unique solution. So you see that the moment you can generate a formula for determining alpha and beta in terms of x1, x2, u1, u2, v1, v2. This is the analytical proof, okay. So given x1, x2, one can always get alpha and beta such that these relations are satisfied, okay. Whereas we discovered the whole thing in terms of geometry. And this is something very fascinating. In mathematics, you can use the geometric image. In many problems, you can use the geometric image, make inferences from there. You can use the analytical computations. And eventually, you, from the geometric image, you know, that argument is not, is more intuitive there. Whereas this is just a dispassionate factual statement that you make from it. Okay, these are two simultaneous equations, and you don't even bother what exactly you are talking about. There are two simultaneous equations, inhomogeneous equations, and what you are saying is that you can solve them and determine alpha and beta. But then see, go back there, what is the meaning of that? Okay, so that's a wonderful aspect of it. Similarly, you can ask the same question in R3. In R3, now you see what happens. In R3, you start with a single vector, non-zero vector. It generates the whole line. It doesn't cover the whole R3. Now, you choose another vector along the same line, you get nothing more. You generate only that through linear sums. But suppose you choose a second vector which is not along this direction, what happens? You get another line covered, and combined with this, with these two vectors together, determine a plane, and that whole plane is covered by these two vectors. Now what one does is, still you have not covered the whole of R3. What you do? You choose a third vector which is not lying in this plane. So you choose three vectors. Now with these three vectors, you can generate any vector in that plane. So we make a statement in R3, What happens? What about the way in which we have chosen the vectors? Chosen the vectors, you see that u is not in the plane determined by v and w. V is not in the plane determined by u and w. W is not in the plane determined by u and v. This is how we have chosen. Okay? So, if you choose three non-zero vectors such that none of them is in the other two, then one can generate a sentence, right? Just read through. In R3, choosing three non-zero vectors such that none of them is in the plane determined by the other two, one can generate R3 as a linear sum of these three vectors. It's clear also. I suppose the meaning is clear. Okay. Now, we can prove this analytically using this method. That is easier because you can't easily draw pictures. It's quite possible because what you can do is you have two vectors, then there is a plane passing through the origin, there is a third vector. Now, what you do is you choose an arbitrary point, you can resolve it along these three directions. Okay? So, what you get would be, instead of a parallelogram, you end up getting a parallelepiped. Okay? And this is the main diagonal will turn out to be the particular vector that you start with. So, that is always possible, but we can analytically prove it. So, what you have? You have, if this is true, there exists, that is question, W. What does it mean? It means x1 equal to alpha u1 plus beta gamma w3. Okay. Now, the problem is, can you solve this for alpha, beta, these are three simultaneous equations in three unknowns, alpha, beta, gamma, are linear equations. And you know from your elementary results on linear equations that this has a solution provided. What is the condition? The determinant of u1 v1 w1 u2 v2 w2 u3 v3 w3 is not equal to 0, then you can solve them and get a unique solution. Okay? So, the condition would be this, that is determinant of this is not equal to 0, but this is exactly what is guaranteed by this condition. Okay? One vector is not in the plain determined by the other two. Okay? In that case, this determinant is not equal to 0, and that is something which you will have to connect. Okay? So, since this is not equal to 0, it follows that given x1, x2, x3, you can find out alpha 1, alpha, beta, gamma, solving these equations. Okay? So, that is the statement. I think I should stop here with this. Okay, thank you.
Sir, is it possible to think of Rn for n greater than 3 and develop the concepts of lines and planes in such spaces?
It's a very interesting question leading to the next level of development of these ideas. In fact, we have been confining ourselves to R2 and R3 mainly because one can draw pictures and the geometry is pretty clear. And Rn is of course a r cross rn times. That is a very natural way in which one can develop. Any discerning student can write down most of these things verbatim by following the path of R2 or R3 by writing x as an ordered n tuple x1, x2, etcetera, xn, again addition as point wise addition of the coordinates, scalar multiplication, multiplying every coordinate by the scalar, etcetera, etcetera. Now, lines are natural. So, you talk about a vector. A vector is x is actually x1, x2, etcetera, xn. And if v is any fixed vector which is not equal to 0, that means one of the, at least one of the component is not equal to 0, because we say that v is 0 if and only if every component is 0. So, at least one of the component is different from 0. Then you can write the equation of a line as x is equal to tv. This is exactly as you did in the case of R2 or R3. And then of course, there are similar representations of lines in the scalar form and the vector form, but they are not something that you can easily conceive, because we live, unfortunately, in the physical world we live in is three dimensional, and higher dimensional spaces you come across in some kind of situations of solving equations or something like that. And many problems can be geared into that language, but certainly you cannot draw the pictures in that case. That is one handicap. Then you have lines, you have the planes, but there are several types of hyperplanes that you conceive of. In fact, you see that in R2, you have a one dimensional object is a line, zero dimensional object is a point, and in then two dimension is the whole space. In R3, you have a zero dimensional space, that is the zero element, one dimensional space, that is every line passing through the origin. Then you have every plane passing through the origin, which is two dimensional object, and then of course, the three dimensional space is the whole space. So, when you consider n, what you have is there is zero dimensional object, one dimensional object corresponding to the conventional lines, and then you have two dimensional objects, three dimensional objects, and so on up to n minus 1 dimensional objects, or an n dimensional object is the whole space. So, you have different types of spaces that come across, and these are called hyper spaces, hyper planes. So, you use the word hyper planes for that. Okay? And these are things that we will consider in the more general scenario when we take up the study of linear spaces. I think that satisfies you. Thank you.